we need to understand one more critical component of a typical token sale offer. If we were to approach investors with this offer and nothing else, we have a huge problem. Remember, the primary goal of investors is to generate a financial return. And that financial return can only be generated by selling the token in exchange for some other preferred asset. But there are only so many buyers in the market at any given time. And at early stages, that number is going to be even smaller. This situation sets us up for a mad, frenzied race to see who can sell first before the price collapses. And it's a race in which everyone loses. This was a huge problem with the original ICOs, but people have now learned the lesson, and so the project in this case would never get funded in the first place. There is a solution. The way we prevent exchange markets from unraveling in this way is to place some controls on how the tokens are released to allocation recipients over time. This gradual accumulation of tokens is achieved by subjecting each allocation to a vesting schedule. Now, vesting was already commonly used in the traditional startup world to regulate the award of equity-linked rights to employees, whether those were shares or options on shares. In the startup world, it was being applied to bring worker incentives into alignment with the long-term performance of the company. However, in our case, because the token typically plays an economic and monetary role within a project, vesting terms now impart a broader set of benefits, so it's worth specifying what these are in detail. The first benefit is the one that led us to the need for vesting in the first place. It creates a device which avoids dumping, panic selling, and market unraveling. Part of the way it does this is by providing visibility and confidence around how the supply of unlocked tokens is going to grow over time. That's achieved by the fact that terms are immutably secured using public smart contracts that are transparent and openly auditable. Vesting also provides an instrument that helps us differentiate between different value contributions and target different investor profiles. It also does provide us with a means to align incentives with long-term performance, much in the same way as was intended in the startup world. It also gives us a way to acknowledge that the value base of an early-stage project starts out small, but is expected to grow over time, and will therefore be able to support a larger monetary base without collapsing the price. And finally, it aligns the supply of tokens with exchange market demand and liquidity. So again, just to stress the point, for tokenized enterprise, vesting has a broader range of effects than vesting does in the more familiar context of the award of equity for startups. So how do we set the vesting? Well, the schedules can be arranged in any arbitrary way, but taking an irregular approach has many downsides. It slows down the drafting and analysis of offers. It slows down the evaluation of offers by investors and counterparties, and it creates unwanted economic effects. An example of this are lumpy vesting schedules, which are generally a bad choice for token distributions. And that's because the token is an economic and incentive resource and is also thinly traded in the early stages of the project's life. That means that sudden changes in supply that don't reflect changes in the value base can create really destabilizing effects on the price. So it's generally better to opt for a smooth vesting schedule instead. This is really helpful because it rules out all kinds of exotic vesting agreements. And from here, it's clear to see that we can satisfy the wishes and concerns of stakeholders with a simple, standardized set of vesting terms that only uses three parameters: an initial unlock, a lock term, and a release term. Let's look at each one of these. Tokens unlocked at listing is expressed as a share of the total token allocation, and it tells you what portion of your assigned allocation is unlocked and freely tradable on the listing date. Let's illustrate this with some charts. On the left-hand side here, we have a case illustrating a lower initial unlock, and on the right, one with a higher initial unlock. On both sides, the top chart shows the marginal unlock schedule. That's the extra tokens that are unlocked according to that schedule. And on the bottom, we have the cumulative unlock schedule, the total quantity of tokens that have been unlocked according to the schedule. Notice that in both cases, all tokens are fully unlocked by the 24th month, so we no longer have any unlocks after that date, and the cumulative chart stays flat after that point. These charts are plotted to the same scales on horizontal and vertical axes to make comparisons clearer. So on the right, we see a higher initial spike of tokens being released, and we see that reflected in the cumulative chart with a higher level of unlocked tokens outstanding from the start. Note that all other vesting attributes in these two cases are the same. So on the left, we also see higher emissions later in the vesting period, which is reflected in a steeper incline in the cumulative chart as shown. The initial unlock gives us a way to directly and strictly regulate the number of tokens available on the listing date. The next parameter we look at is the lock period. This is the main device that's used to allay fears about dumping, and it also helps us to align incentives with long-term performance. The way this works is that whatever balance was not unlocked at listing will remain locked for a period of time, a term, that's typically counted in a number of months. Let's illustrate this with charts, using the same layout as before. This time, the left-hand side shows a short lock term, and the right shows a long lock term. Now, if we had kept all the other terms the same, we see that the longer lock leads to a higher unlock rate, which is also reflected in a steeper curve in the cumulative chart on the right-hand side. That assumes we are holding the final date for which tokens are fully vested constant. But if we allow that end date to shift back so we keep the same unlock rate as we had before, we see that the lockup term is now back shifting the entire unlock schedule relative to the one that we had on the left-hand side. Now we get to the final term or parameter of this standardized contract, which is the release term. This is the period of time during which all those locked tokens get unlocked after the expiry of the lock period. Again, this is a time period that's usually counted in months. In the interests of simplicity, this is usually done in a linear fashion, meaning the same number of tokens get released in each time period. Now, what we said earlier about smoothing recommends that the amount is calculated on a daily basis where possible. That also helps spread sell pressure by actors who may be claiming their tokens on different days. Illustrating this in charts, again, a shorter release term is shown on the left, which leads to a higher unlock rate towards the end of the vesting term, and a longer release term is shown on the right-hand side, which, as you can see, leads to a lower unlock rate and a more gradual accumulation of unlocked tokens. So hopefully you can see that these three terms are great all-rounders for addressing stakeholder concerns around a token sale offering. We can strictly regulate the tokens that are available at listing, and we can defer the unlock of tokens in a clear and unambiguous way. And then we can also stretch out the release of tokens in an effort to align incentives with long-term performance. Now, it's worth noting that the wording I'm using here is not standardized, so please check in with all relevant parties to make sure that you understand exactly what the term means if they use different words. But there is one common semantic conflict that I do want to raise here, and that's concerning what I have called the lock term. You'll see a lot of projects call this a cliff, but I prefer to avoid this term because it generally means something very different in the token space than it does in the equity space. The way that cliffs are defined in the vesting contracts for equity are as initial periods where a vested right begins to accrue, but where that accrual does not itself vest until the cliff period expires, whereupon the accrual accumulated over the cliff period vests in its entirety, as you can see with that spike in the chart there. After the cliff, vesting often continues to accrue, but thereafter vests at the same time incrementally, according to some regular defined recognition period. These cliffs from the equity world make sense as ways of securing some minimum term of service before these awards are granted. It's also worth remembering that there is no liquid market for owners to sell their shares or options into. If there is a public market, it is deep enough for any liquidations by grantees to be inconsequential, not to mention that equity shares and their value aren't active economic resources in the business. If we were to apply these traditional cliffs to token vesting, we see that it creates sudden changes in unlocked supply, which can create destabilizing market pricing and economic effects. Even so, I guess lockups came to be called cliffs because that sounded cool. But let's be clear, in a token vesting contract, they typically just refer to what I've been calling the lock period. At the end of the token cliff, there is no accumulated accrual that suddenly vests, just marks the end of a lock period, and the tokens begin to unlock in a gradual manner, as we'd expect. Look, at the end of the day, what matters with language is that everyone understands the same thing that you do. So whenever you hear cliffs being mentioned, just double check that you're all talking about the same thing. To avoid confusion, I won't be using them in that way. And that completes our introduction to the basics of how a token sale is structured. A set of tokens is pre-mined or created at Genesis. That supply is split up into a number of allocations with distinct uses and beneficiaries, in addition to those which are sold to external investors. Vesting terms are applied to each allocation to address a range of monetary, economic, and market trading concerns. Smoother vesting is generally better in all cases. You typically only need three parameters to cover most of the concerns involved, and the terms are enforced by public blockchain smart contracts. So, how do stakeholders interpret these offers? Well, that's going to be the focus of the next lecture.